change the world. I'll tell you first a little bit about the Institute, then a bit about the lecture series, and then I'm going to introduce Prudy. The Chicago Institute for Psychoanalysis began in 1932. In its founding statement, Brandon proclaimed that the Institute's goals are to, and this is a quote, believe me, to increase the knowledge of the psychic processes of man. Franz Alexander, the Institute's first director, put it this way: the work of the Chicago Institute will make for a better understanding of psychoanalysis. Its guiding principle will be the pursuance of psychoanalytic thought and research, bold and uncompromising in its search for truth. It is lofty language, and we really wouldn't use it today. This was back in 1932. And yet, this is a tradition that I believe we still uphold. For all its complexity, psychoanalysis has some simple truths at its core: that people are motivated by unconscious thoughts and feelings that guide their lives. This has implications for our neighborhoods and communities as well, of course. And as Prudy will show us this evening, this story beneath the surface of all human activity is absolutely central to understanding and changing the world, whether for an individual, for our professional groups, or for our larger community. This is the real power of psychoanalysis. To put this into action at the Institute, we offer educational programs and clinical services, and we are a center for psychoanalytic scholarship and research. We train child and adult psychoanalysts in a rigorous educational program. We train child and adult psychoanalytic psychotherapists as well. And we offer a fellowship program for those interested in learning about psychoanalysis. We have a continuing education program that offers courses, workshops, and this lecture series here this evening. In addition to training and education, the Institute provides extensive clinical services to children, adolescents, and adults on a sliding fee scale. The clinics of the Institute for Psychoanalysis provide an important service to the community, and these clinics also demonstrate the kind of change that is possible in individual lives when psychoanalysis is at the heart of what we do. The five lectures of psychoanalysis today will expand our understanding of the heart of psychoanalysis. In addition to this evening's discussion about the psychoanalyst as citizen, we will be exploring new views on the unconscious, living an ethical life, subjectivity as a central value, and the role of neuroscience in psychoanalysis. Charles Jaffe will be our next speaker, subtitled his talk on the unconscious today. His subtitle was, "It's Not Your Grandparents' Unconscious." Indeed, psychoanalysis today at the Chicago Institute as it helps individuals have more meaningful lives, and it looks outward to the world around us. Psychoanalysis helps us make meaning of our internal worlds and the outside world, and this is psychoanalysis today. Before I introduce Maria, just a few housekeeping notes. If you want to receive continuing education credits for this evening's program, just make sure you've signed in with your email address, because that will all be handled electronically. If you need a parking voucher for the Adams Wabash Garage, those are available at the registration desk. And then the format for this evening is going to be Prudy's lecture, and then at the end of that, we'll open it up for questions, comments, reactions, and conversation among all of us. So hold on to your reactions, your thoughts, and we'll have an opportunity for conversation at the end. When I originally planned this lecture series, I thought it made most sense to have Prudy's lecture at the end out into the wider world. But as you might imagine, juggling the schedules of five psychoanalysts meant that you can't always do what you planned. And in fact, I think it actually makes a lot of sense to begin with her talk, because she's going to help us have a very broad picture of what psychoanalysis means today. So to introduce Prudence, Prudence Gourguechon MD is a psychiatrist and psychoanalyst. She's a graduate of the Chicago Institute of Psychoanalytic Education Program and a faculty member. In her private practice, she works with individuals and with organizations working toward transformational change, whether with one person or an organization. Prudy has also been very active on a national and international level. She's a past president of the American Psychoanalytic Association, and she's spearheaded several important initiatives started the 10,000 Minds Project there, which had a goal of introducing undergraduates to psychoanalysis to help them appreciate the relevance of psychoanalytic thought to academic disciplines. She also helped establish the Service Members and Veterans Initiative for APSA, recognizing the contributions psychoanalysis can make to the mental health needs of this group. You can see from these examples that Prudy thinks both preventively and positively, with a commitment to underserved populations. For the International Psychoanalytic Association, Prudy has worked on enhancing their public information and communications efforts. And she's a blogger and a Twitterer. She sees social media as an unparalleled opportunity to connect with the outside world and to convey the lessons of psychoanalysis. As she says, she is passionate about the power of psychoanalysis to affect social change outside the analyst's office and to help deepen public understanding of, as she put it, the oddities of human behavior. I asked Prudy this evening what got her interested in the social justice aspect of psychoanalysis, and she gave the perfect psychoanalytic answer. She said it was my mother. as a child, she accompanied her family to civil rights demonstrations and other demonstrations on a weekly basis, and we have tonight the pleasure of hearing the fruit of all of that.
Why do
people vote against their self-interest? Why would anyone support Donald Trump? And if you listen for the constant hum of why, you'll also hear all sorts of experts called upon to answer the questions. But none of them have our particular expertise about the powerful forces that lie hidden beneath the surface of human behavior. I'm not pretending that psychoanalysts have all the answers, but we do add an element of understanding that no other discipline provides, and that is the element of depth and complexity. All analysts do not agree with me that we should embrace our identity as public intellectuals. While the role has a noble history going back to Freud, who wrote about war, civilization, art, and other vital issues of his troubled world, still there has always been a strain of opposition within our field. Some think it unseemly, or even anti-psychoanalytic, or you can't be a good psychoanalyst if you do this kind of work. But I'm not going to spend time on this debate tonight. To my mind, this is one of the most exciting areas where analysts can make amazing contributions. I have this idea that I've played with for quite a while now, which is that your ordinary psychoanalyst can say something interesting, important, and psychoanalytic about anything. Any question or issue that has to do with human beings. I think it would be fun to test this out in an event like this or a dinner party. Just throw up topics and say something psychoanalytic. I haven't done that yet. I have used the ideas in workshops teaching people to use social media, blogging, and other modern communications tools. So in case you don't know what the problematic issues of our world today are, here's a little description. These are just some of them, of course, and I picked these because they are areas in which the analysts I'm going to tell you about tonight have done work. Now, the next slide is really my favorite. This is Prudence Gourguechon's reduction of psychoanalysis to 9 concepts. This is psychoanalysis. You don't really need to know anything else. And I've proven this. This is well proven. So, in work on social issues, the middle of the list, defense and resistance often come up, but you will see defense of disavowal is particularly important. But you'll see as I talk about examples of psychoanalytic public work in the public sphere, listen for which of these 9 parts of psychoanalysis is being used by the analyst in his work, his or her work. The way I do this work is if somebody asks me to comment on something, and you'll see some of the more absurd and more serious examples of this, I kind of free associate to the issue, just like you would with a patient's material. And see, with these core concepts in the back of my mind, I see what kind of comes up. Or you might think of it, if you don't want to think of it as psychoanalysis, kind of like a magic eight ball. You know, which little concept comes up to the time. And it's really not so different from listening to a patient's material with free-floating attention. As I go through the examples that follow, you'll see creative and unexpected applications of the basic concept. I'm going to start off slowly, soft, with a few of the lighter examples, a few of the lighter opportunities I've had to put this idea that a psychoanalyst can say something about anything into practice. So, I got a call from a reporter 2009, to ask me if I could explain the popularity of the decor style known as shabby chic. The reporter had the idea that the style seemed to be most popular in times of economic recession. Well, I had the easy answer, of course. I explained the concept of regression in times of stress. The reporter and I wondered together if we could link fluctuations in the regressive appeal the shabby chic style, or even comfort food, or vanilla ice cream, to the ups and downs in the stock market. The idea we came up with was that the fantasy of curling up on a squishy sofa would help one ride out the anxiety caused by the storms of economic troubles. Well, as some of you might
star Britney Spears shaved her hair off one day in 2007 as the whole world watched. I got an urgent call from the Chicago Sun-Times, from a reporter, to see if I could offer an expert opinion about why anyone would do that. I should mention that Maxine Kroll, owner of Maxine's Salon at 712 North Rush Street, also got such an urgent call because she was quoted before me in the article that came out. I don't mind sharing. Maxine gives her opinion that Britney's behavior is basically inexplicable and bizarre, and says that's even to a hairdresser who's exposed to many bizarre behaviors. Then I got to talk. I should mention seriously that there's an ethical problem for psychoanalysts. When you're speaking about a public figure, it is unethical, and I take this extremely seriously, to comment on their mental state. You're not allowed to say anything about someone you haven't personally interviewed. So rather than speculating on Spears' state of mind, I kind of reassociated in general about hair and women. And I find it's actually more fun to construct a theory about human behavior on the fly than to just diagnose someone by proxy. So let's see what I came up with about Britney's hair. I couldn't believe this when I dredged it up. So it's Prudence Gourguechon MD, a Chicago psychiatrist who's president-elect of the American Psychoanalytic Association, said hair has always been a sexual symbol with connotations to femininity. While cutting hair has been to be associated with power. And then I went on for some reason. I remember being fascinated when I read the nun's story as a girl, Gourguechon said, in the sense that it was submissive, giving up sexuality, submitting to God. My personal feeling is not so much that it is a masculine identification as a distancing from an overly female identity, or just a search for power. Now, you might ask where I get these ideas. The answer is easy. I make them up. That's the whole point. With 35 years of experience as an analyst, I get to make things like this up. I get to say what I think about things as an expert in human behavior, and so do you. Well, I'll get to some of my more serious work, which I do have, towards the end of this talk. But first, I want to convey both the depth and breadth of psychoanalytic work in the community and with social issues. I'm going to start with some detail about two remarkable British analysts, John Alderdice and Sally Weintraub. Has anybody in the room heard of either of them? Which one?
Weintraub?
No, we're sort of Alderdice. We'll really be here about them. They have used psychoanalytic knowledge to profound effect in two very different social problem areas. I hope these two examples will give you a feeling for the in-depth process that an individual analyst might go through in developing this type of practice. And I see this work as part of a psychoanalytic practice. One part might be individual work, and one part might be this kind of public psychoanalysis. After I give some rather in-depth stories about Alderdice and Weintraub, I'm going to mention a handful of colleagues very briefly. Their work will give you a sense of the breadth and range of social problems that public psychoanalysts are addressing. Using psychoanalytic concepts and interventions, these men and women have made unique and, in some instances, extraordinary contributions to understanding the vital issues of our troubled world today. I realized as I was putting this talk together that these are my psychoanalytic heroes. Finally, I will talk about some of my work having to do with war and disavowal. So, now I want to tell you the story of Lord John Alderdice. I believe, I'm not positive, but I think he is the only Lord psychoanalyst in the world. If anybody knows of another one, please tell me. When I first heard about his work, it simply blew my mind. It exploding the potential of psychoanalysis beyond anything I had ever imagined. I want to make an important acknowledgement. I learned about Alderdice from my friend and colleague, Marie Rudden, who wrote a profile of him for the for TAP, the magazine of the American Psychoanalytic Association, in 2004, after he'd given a talk at the APSA meeting in January. And if that's not an advertisement for the APSA meeting, I don't know what it would be. So much of what I'm going to say comes from Marie's article. John Alderdice was born in 1955, the son of a Protestant minister in Belfast, Northern Ireland. As a teenager in the 1960s and 70s, Alderdice was struck by, quote, this is quoting him, frightening and stimulating violence on his own streets and affecting members of his extended family. He was convinced that such self-destructive activities could not be explained only by economic or political arguments, and wondered if a psychoanalytic approach might aid in understanding them. He says, it was, at least in part, the struggle to find a more persuasive way of understanding the communal suffering where I was growing up in Northern Ireland, which led me to psychoanalysis. This does not sound like a normal teenager. But you should know, our research has found that most psychoanalysts first encounter and fall in love with psychoanalysis as adolescents or college students. So it's really not quite as remarkable. He's obviously a very special person, but it is not unheard of. In case you missed this, let me underscore the point. Alderdice, trained in medicine and psychiatry and psychoanalysis in order to make a contribution to the unending problem of violence in his homeland. Concurrently with his psychiatric and psychoanalytic training, Alderdice was deeply involved in politics. To quote him again, one can't just put out a brass plate announcing political psychoanalyst, but one must get involved politically so that when you make an interpretation, it will be listened to. He began his psychiatric practice in 1988. By then, he had worked his way up through the leadership ranks of the Alliance Party. I don't quite understand how he did all this at the same time, but he did. The Alliance Party was a peace party that included both Catholic and Protestant members. And he rose to the position of party chair about the time he opened his practice, I think. He was an architect of a plan for a coalition government for Northern Ireland. He called governing with consent. And he was one of the key negotiators of Ireland's Belfast Agreement signed on Good Friday, 1998. In 1987, Alderdice conceived of a process he called talks about talks. This process included all the parties to the conflict, including the much feared Sinn Féin, who previously had been excluded from conversations because they were seen as too extreme. The Talks About Talks groups met monthly for 4 years. That's the psychoanalysis. Alderdice conceptualized these conversations as an attempt to create a political therapeutic process. In later writings, he described his strategy as a political psychoanalyst. He emphasizes the importance of understanding the tremendous anxiety members and leaders of both sides of a conflict experience, and how they defensively process and express this anxiety. He viewed the anger, frustration, and resistance to the peace talks he witnessed as expressions of annihilation anxiety. Each side had not just fantasies of annihilation, but actual experiences historically to remind them of this possibility. And as in the psychoanalysis of individuals, the history of past conflicts and traumas could not be ignored. Was very aware and conscious of these ideas and how he was using them all along. He describes his encounters with some English ministers, I guess that means government people, at the negotiating table, who couldn't believe that the memories of 1641, when some of our people were massacred by these people, were still invoked with great emotion. But Alderdice says, if 40 or 50 years expert individual doesn't ameliorate certain early traumas, which may even be passed on to another generation, then several hundred years for a whole nation to process grave historical events does not seem so long. And this always makes me think of slavery in the US, which I think we have not yet processed. Just as psychoanalysts understand the time it takes to excavate the underpinnings of conflicts and symptoms with an individual patient, Alderdice had a long-term perspective on the treatment of his homeland. In his political psychoanalytic work, he consciously employed psychoanalytic ideas of development and regression, instinctual drives, predominantly aggression, the death instinct, defenses and their transformation, and transference and countertransference. In tribute to his work, Alderdice was made a British peer with a seat in the House of Lords in 1996. He currently serves there as head of the Liberal Party, Liberal Democratic Party. In 1998, he became a member of the newly formed Northern Ireland Assembly, a governing body that resulted from the successful peace process he had shepherded. He represented Belfast East, the neighborhood he grew up in, and served the Assembly as its first speaker until 2004. He continues to work in the field of peace and understanding international terrorism. In 2002, he wrote, armed only with non-analytic explanations of violence, our world community will not make sense of terrorist attacks like those of September 11, 2001. Speaking about terrorism a few years later in his 2004 talk at the APSA meeting, Alderdice said, and you can see here, he's always making interpretations and looking for the tact and timing for the right place, right time and place to deliver them. He says that because of the amount of fear engendered by terrorist acts, it is very difficult for the attacked group to hear interpretations aimed at understanding the acts. Alderdice thinks that, given this, groups often need external help to be able to listen and interpret the historical context and particular motivations behind terrorist actions, and thus understand the best way to respond to them. His own mission and his charge to his audience of psychoanalysts at that time was to contribute to such a body of knowledge so that, quote, if one can keep lighting a candle rather than cursing the darkness, one can make a genuine contribution to change as I am. I will orient orient you with this picture. According to Weintraub, in this early attempt at developing a psychoanalytic theory about humans and climate change, our denial stems in part from the unwillingness to acknowledge our own rapacious greed, leading to shame and mounting anxiety. She says, avoiding guilt and shame through quick fixes leads to increasing stupidity. And here, I got to include this quote. And here the original meaning of the word stupid is revealing, she writes. It means stupefied, struck dumb with grief. Sally Weintraub is up and running as a public psychoanalyst. The next year, in 2011, she joined with several colleagues at the British Society to offer a two-day public program called Engaging with Climate Change, Psychoanalytic Perspectives. The British Society has a wonderful outreach arm they call Beyond the Couch that holds many public lectures and mini courses. This interdisciplinary conference brought together psychoanalysts, sociologists, climate scientists, experts in international development, as well as environmental activists and a historian of science. Note here, the work of a public psychoanalyst is of necessity interdisciplinary and collaborative. This can be a problem for some of us who don't always like to work with other people. But you can get over it. So, the conference led to a book, more or less the same thing. And Sally Weintraub, she was the editor of the book. It was a collection of pieces from the conference. She went on to public speaking engagements, media interviews, YouTube videos, an active Twitter presence, and further interdisciplinary collaborations. Along the way, Weintraub's psychoanalytic thinking about climate change and our human response to it matured, becoming more complex and nuanced, as one might expect from an analyst immersed in delving deeply for 4 years into one subject. The same applies to psychoanalysis, doesn't it? Here is how she expresses some of her thinking a few years later. Quote, a key psychoanalytic point is that with disavowal, the more we push reality to the margins, the more our underlying anxieties about survival, about guilt of both depressive and paranoid schizoid types build up, leading us potentially to resort to further disavowal. And this quote, as we become less able to remain undisturbed by mounting evidence of climate change, we may succumb to fatalistic propaganda that it is all too late and end up feeling hopeless, concluding we might as well now adjust to the tough situation of climate instability while carrying on with the perverse business as usual, more disavowal. She goes on, as psychoanalysts, we have vital knowledge and a unique perspective to offer about many aspects of our response to climate change. This includes a difficulty in accepting damage we are implicated in, particularly when it is irreparable. How excessive guilt makes repair difficult. We know, as analysts, that to bear profoundly difficult truths, we need non-judgmental understanding, support, and containment of anxiety. What I like so much about Weintraub's work is that she focuses on understanding the subjective experience of humans experiencing climate change and trying to function within cultural or political systems that are dealing with it in one way or another. This emphasis on the subjective experience in relation to a social problem is where psychoanalysts can contribute in a way that no one else really can. The citizen psychoanalyst, no matter what issue he or she is interested in, should endeavor to make a contribution that is uniquely psychoanalytic. What aspect of the problem can we understand and explain that no one from any other discipline or perspective can? The realm of the subjective response to social problems, whether the problem is climate change or gun control, is always an arena that is neglected. This goes back to the problem of, for example, why do we tolerate so many guns in our country? And it's an arena that's neglected, and it's always a place where our analytic knowledge can make a contribution. I want close the discussion of Sally Wontrop's work with a story I find very heartening. The introduction to her book on psychoanalytic perspectives of climate change was actually written by a climate scientist, not an analyst. A man named Chris Rapley, who's a professor at University College London. He writes, to the climate scientist, bemused by the fit, British people write so well, but it's hard to read the quotes because there's a lot of clauses. To the climate scientist, bemused by the failure of the widely held but flawed information deficit model, in which non-experts are seen as empty vessels who will respond appropriately once informed of the facts, it is a revelation and relief to discover that this sequence of denial is all too familiar to those who deal with the workings of the human mind. By providing a deeper understanding of ways in which people think and feel about climate change, the psychoanalytic perspective offers a basis for understanding and thereby hopefully better overcoming sources of resistance to evidence and the need for action. So essentially, the climate scientist said, whoa, these people who've been thinking about denial and resistance for 100 years, and we should really talk to them. And they become very interested in London and talking to psychoanalysts. So, if you want to be a public psychoanalyst, where do you actually practice? Well, anywhere. At your office, your society, or your institute. Besides getting out of the confines of psychoanalytic spaces, you have to learn to communicate the way people do these days. And that includes, that means being willing to learn something about social media, blogs, websites, and other potentially frightening 20-year-old entities. You have to learn to talk about complex psychoanalytic ideas in everyday language. It sharpens your thinking when you can't rely on jargon. Or you have to get a psychoanalytic idea across in the 140 characters allowed in a tweet. And you have to work with others. Now I'm going to turn to the work of other psychoanalytic colleagues who I consider to be exemplary citizen psychoanalysts.